As I was looking at my lesson tonight, two thoughts hit me. One was, I really wished I hadn't planned a 45-minute lesson with a meal coming on. The second one is, I really shouldn't be preaching against gluttony tonight. No. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we're so very glad that you are God. You give us your word, and in your word, you reveal to us the things that we need to understand about ourselves, about you, how it is that we can draw closer to you, the choices that we have before us and the ones we need to make, that we might know you as our Lord, our Father, our Savior. You give us all these things, Lord, and on top of that, you give us the desires of our hearts. That's a big thing. How is it that we can come into that, Lord, those promises that you make? What are the things that we need to choose to do to live right before you? Help us to do that. It's through Jesus we pray. Amen. So we are in book one, and this is number 37 of the 150 Psalms. So we're almost there. Almost there. It is attributed to David, 73 out of the 150 are, and it is categorized as a psalm of wisdom. So David, as we learned in our adult class this morning, as he was writing a lot of these psalms, it was in a time when he was going through a lot of anguish. Saul or others were against him, and they were trying to harm him. It was a time when society was unraveling, and so we can truly identify, I think, even further with the figure of David, as we can look at what's going on in our own world around us and see some similarities, see some patterns, but also for the Christian, we can look and say, what can we glean from David, who was writing at this particular time in the Psalms? What does he write about? How can we get through? Where can we find strength, and how can we draw closer to God? Psalm 37 is an acrostic poem, meaning that it takes the letters of the Hebrew alphabet, and each line or each section starts with that particular letter. Psalm 119, of course, is the longest chapter in the Bible, but it's also an acrostic poem. It has 176 verses. Psalm 37 does not, so we rest easy there. The theme of Psalm 37 is the problem of power, prosperity, and greed of the wicked. Doesn't that sound like a psalm that might help us out today? As we look around in the world and the political situation, our country situation, and it just seems like there's so many things that are going wrong and going the way that God would not like us to go. How does a Christian exist in a world such as that? How do we keep ourselves pure and clean? How do we draw closer to God? And I think Psalm 37 has a lot to say about it. Psalm 37 has a lot of verses, and so we're actually going to break this psalm up into two different parts. We're going to catch the first half this Sunday, and then next Sunday, we're going to catch, Sunday evening, we'll catch the second half. Other psalms that also deal with the same theme, the problem of power, prosperity, and greed of the wicked, are Psalms 10, 49, and 73. So if you're looking for a little extra homework, and you want to go back and read some of those psalms and see how it matches up with tonight's psalm, that would be a good idea. And so if David is an artist, in some senses, writing psalms, which were often put to music and people were listening to, and they were gaining great faith and encouragement from, we can also say that in today's society, as we look at a time of unraveling as well, when we're facing similar struggles and problems, what artists today might also be writing on a similar theme. Perhaps you've heard of this guy. He, in the last just month or so, has come out with several songs, and they all seem to be on the same theme that David is dealing with in Psalm 37, but he's dealing with it in a more modern sense, has the same theme for our unraveling. And so we're going to be looking tonight at how is it that we can persevere in such difficult times. And in an unraveling society, we must trust in the Lord. The first thing that David tells us right from verse 1 is fret not. Fret not. I like that. Fret not. I thought maybe we'd have a t-shirt or something that says fret not right on there. There's verse 1. Fret not yourself because of evildoers. Be not envious of wrongdoers. You can understand how God's people might be tempted to want to follow in the ways of the world and compromise in the way that the world would have us compromise, because it seems like the wicked have it easy. The wicked have a great life. Seems like they have a multitude of possessions and everything seems to be going well. If only we weren't against greed and we weren't against unlawful gain and all these things that we see the world afterwards, that maybe we could share in some of those things that we see the world having as well. But we're told to fret not because of them. Don't be envious. And I think that word is key there in verse 1. It's the same thing that's said in Proverbs 24 in verse 19. This, of course, Proverbs attributed more to Solomon. This is a psalm written by David, his father. But we can see the same thing written, inspired by the Holy Spirit. Fret not yourself because of evildoers, and be not envious of the wicked. Maybe in some part, Solomon knew of his dad's psalm and was able to bring that over. And this whole idea is that the wicked seem to thrive. In Jeremiah's day, we know that Jeremiah, writing at the time of the Babylonian captivity, as God's people were to be taken off, and it seems like, again, another unraveling in society, that the wicked are certainly prospering more than what we see in other places. And Jeremiah is writing, "Righteous are you, O Lord, when I complain to you. Yet I would plead my case before you. Why does the way of the wicked prosper? Why do all who are treacherous thrive?" That seems to be the way of it, isn't it? And here's God's answer in verse 2 of our psalm. He says, "For they will soon fade like the grass and wither like the green herb." God says they're temporary. It's not going to be long, and you're going to see that they fade, they wither. In Matthew 6, we can see here is Jesus is giving the Sermon on the Mount, and he is talking about not being anxious or don't worry. It says, "Why are you anxious about clothing? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They neither toil nor spin. Yet I tell you, even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. But if God so clothes the grass of the field, which today is alive and tomorrow is thrown into the oven, will he not much more clothe you, O you of little faith?" And so that seems to be the end of grass or herbs or something that is very temporary. Yes, it may look beautiful. It may look like it's thriving. The wicked certainly look like they're prospering out in society, but they're very fleeting, and it won't be long before they're cut down, gathered together, and burned in the fire. We can even understand that from what Jesus taught us. As we go to verse 3, it says, "Trust in the Lord and do good, dwell in the land, and befriend faithfulness." Here, God gives us four different actions that we are to do instead. Instead of spending our time and our energy in envy of what the wicked seem to have around us, instead put it into trust, doing good, dwelling, and befriending faithfulness. In other words, hang out with God's people. Hang out with people who are doing what is right. Encourage that. Find ways to get involved with that. And that is a better choice for you to make. If you put all four of those together, trust, do good, dwell, and befriend, you come up with, I think, the word abide. I think this is what Jesus is talking about in John 15 when he says, abide in me and I in you. As the branch cannot bear fruit by itself unless it abides in the vine, neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he is, it is, that bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. If anyone does not abide in me, he is thrown away like a branch and withers, and the branches are gathered, thrown into the fire, and burned. Again, a second reference to the temporariness of those things that seem stronger, seem more beautiful, but their end is very fleeting, and they are gathered together and burned. And so the choice that God really puts before us, that David is telling us about in Psalm 37, is either flourish by making right choices or burn. And so we can look at verses 4 through 6 for more of what God would like us to do. It says, delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Notice there's something that we need to do, and then we tap into God's blessing that he gives to us. Delight yourself in the Lord. How would we do that? Spending time with him, reading his word, praying more, serving him more, finding others to encourage and serve. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord, trust in him, and he will act. You see, we're not committing ourselves, we're not trusting ourselves, and we're saying, why isn't God acting? We want to sit back and do us in the way we want to live, and we expect God to act. He will bring forth your righteousness as the light and your justice as the noonday. So though we may feel like we're not getting our justice in this world, God will make sure that it happens if we commit ourselves to him and live for him instead. And so it becomes like a downward or an upward spiral, doesn't it? Sometimes we say to ourselves, well, the world is spiraling down. How come I can't just continue to spiral down with it and expect God to do great things in my life? Instead, God says you need to break that cycle. You need to spiral upward, make better choices, and then you'll see that God will follow through with much better things going on in your life. Jeremiah 31, 33, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. That passage of Jeremiah 31 is where God is speaking about the new covenant that will be made at a future time, a time when Jesus would go to the cross, and it would be the blood of a new covenant that would be shed there. And the result of that is not only forgiveness of sins, but we have a relationship with God now, that he is our God and we are his people because of that. In an unraveling society, we must rest in the Lord. Rest in the Lord. I've never been one to rest. And as I've moved down here and I'm in my 50s now, suddenly my body is telling me I need to do a little more resting. I don't know. I never used to rest. Used to go all the time, all the time. And Angie's really good about telling me I need to rest at times and telling me it's important to rest. And I need to listen to my wife a little bit more. Well, God is telling us that we need to take some time to be still and know that he is God, Psalm 46. But here in verse 7 of Psalm 37, it says, be still before the Lord and wait patiently for him. Fret not, second time he says that, fret not yourself over the one who prospers in his way, over the man who carries out evil devices. See, we can turn on our TVs, we can watch the news, listen to a news feed that comes through, and we can see about all these evil doers and their evil devices and the things that they are planning and plotting, and we can get ourselves all fretted up. But he says, fret not yourself over the one who prospers in his way, the way that he wants to go. because God is in control. In Exodus chapter 14, when all of Pharaoh's army is chasing after the Israelites and their backs are up against the Red Sea, and God is speaking to Moses and says, hold out your staff and the sea will open. It'll become just like dry land. All the Israelites will be able to escape through the Red Sea, and all the Egyptians that follow them, okay, their cartwheels are going to get bogged down in the mud and they're going to drown. You'll never see these Israelites again. Moses said to the people, fear not, stand firm and see the salvation of the Lord, which he will work for you today. For the Egyptians whom you see today, you shall never see again. The Lord will fight for you, and you only have to be silent. The NIV says, be still. And I think there's some wisdom in there in allowing God to act. You know, it's wonderful to have a little kid helping you, you know, doing whatever task it is. But sometimes you're like, okay, just stand there and let me do this, right? Whatever it is. Because you know it's going to take eight times as long and probably won't get done at all if that kid keeps helping you. And you want the help. You want them to help you. But sometimes it's watch grandpa or grandma or whatever it is work and let me show you something here. And I think God is showing himself to the Israelites, yes, but also to the Egyptians in his in what he will do. So we are to refrain or fret not from these things. Here's the word refrain in verse 8. Refrain from anger and forsake wrath. Fret not yourself. There's maybe what the t-shirt needs to say. Fret not yourself. Third time he says it. It tends only to evil. So we are to refrain from anger. Ephesians chapter 4 says, be angry and do not sin. Do not let the sun go down on your anger. And we are to refrain from wrath, forsake wrath, as he says in verse 8. He says, repay no one evil for evil in Romans 12, but give thought to do what is honorable in the sight of all. If possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave it to the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. And so if we do this, if we are silent, if we allow God to act and work in our lives as we are trusting and committing to him, as we're told at the beginning of the psalm, if we wait, we have an inheritance. Verse 9 and 10, for the evildoers shall be cut off, but those who wait for the Lord shall inherit the land. In just a little while, the wicked will be no more. Though you look carefully at his place, he will not be there. And so we need to stay, we need to be silent, we need to be still, and the wicked will disappear. This fits one of the parables that Jesus says in Matthew chapter 13, the parable of the weeds and the tares, or the wheat and the tares. But he said, no, lest in gathering the weeds you root up the wheat along with them, let both grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time I will tell the reapers, gather the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned. A third reference now to burning of the wicked, but gather the wheat into my barn. This explains why we look out and see so much evil in the world today. Some people might ask you, why does God allow so much evil out there in the world? Well, here's the answer. Jesus told us in the parable what would happen. We are to be meek instead. Verse 11, but the meek shall inherit the land and delight themselves in abundant peace. Well, this sounds a lot like, again, Jesus' Sermon on the Mount. Verse 5 of chapter 5, he says, blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And this abundant peace that we'll delight ourselves in, we can see Jesus speaking about this in the New Testament, Philippians chapter 4. Do not be anxious about anything. Again, that's the second time we've heard that from Jesus' mouth, or by the inspiration of the Spirit. But in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. How is it that we could find peace in such a world that we live in with everything falling apart around us, it's trusting in God. And everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, going to God, committing ourselves to Him, trusting in Him, and God will see it through. In an unraveling society, know that the wicked are temporary. So the wicked plot, certainly, but God laughs at the plots. I love this, that David throws this into this psalm, because the imagery here is really good. It's really good from our perspective. As we look out at the world, it seems like they're winning. It seems like at every turn they get the upper hand on those who would choose to do things God's way. But God just sits up there and laughs about it because He knows that they are very fleeting indeed. The wicked plots against the righteous and gnashes his teeth at him. But the Lord laughs at the wicked, for He sees that His day is coming. You see, all their plots, all the things that they're doing, are all in vain. We saw this in Psalm 2, and it's also echoed in the very beginning of the book of Acts, as well as we've been going through that study in Acts. But here it is in Psalm 2. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings of the earth set themselves, and the rulers take counsel together against the Lord and against His anointed, saying, "Let us burst their bonds apart and cast away their cords from us." He who sits in the heavens laughs. The Lord holds them in derision. He's in control. He's got it. And no matter how much it looks like the world is falling apart around us, God is sitting up there saying, "They don't have anything. I'm in control. I'm in power, and my people need to trust in me," God says. That's good news indeed. And how much temporary are they? Look at the weapons that the wicked employ and how they're turned against them, as David continues here in this psalm, verse 14 and 15. The wicked draw the sword and bend their bows to bring down the poor and needy, to slay those whose way is upright. Their sword shall enter their own heart, and their bows shall be broken. It's going to be turned against them. Psalm 11 tells us something very similar. It says, "In the Lord I take refuge. How can you say to my soul, flee like a bird to your mountain? For behold, the wicked bend the bow, and they have fitted their arrow to the string to shoot in the dark at the upright in heart. If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do?" Well, they can trust in God, because God is their refuge. God is their mountain. God gives us a heritage. And as we round out this psalm, the last few verses here, we see that God gives a heritage to those who do make those right choices and don't compromise with the world. It says, "Better is the little that the righteous has than the abundance of many wicked. For the arms of the wicked shall be broken, but the Lord upholds the righteous. The Lord knows the days of the blameless, and their heritage will remain forever. They are not put to shame in evil times." I'll say that again. They are not put to shame in evil times. In the days of famine, they shall have abundance. Abundance. God is there when it seems like everything is stretched so thin for God's people in this wicked time. And yet God is saying, "You shall have my abundance." In the New Testament, 1 Peter 1 and verse 4 says, "An inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you." And so the last couple of verses here, we see a blessing and a curse that is out there. Now the world would flip this on its head and it would say that we're the ones who are cursed and they're the ones who have the blessing. And from a human perspective, that certainly seems to be the way it is, isn't it? The world has everything, and we should not be envious of them, as verse 1 told us. But that's not the way of it at all. It's actually flip-flopped in a spiritual perspective from God's eyes. "But the wicked will perish. The enemies of the Lord are like the glory of the pastures. They vanish like the smoke. They vanish away." It's like that grass that's gathered together and burned in the fire. "The wicked borrows but does not pay back, but the righteous is generous and gives. For For those blessed by the Lord shall inherit the land, but those cursed by him shall be cut off. What a great place to stop in the middle of Psalm 37. But we can see these same promises being given to Abram, who would become the father of faith, and we are Abraham's children if we follow in the footsteps of Abraham. And God made this promise to him, so I will bless those who bless you, and him who dishonors you I will curse. And in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. And Abram believed God, and it was credited to him as righteousness. Verse 6, and we are inheritors of that promise. God is on our side because we are his children. In closing, David found evil times under Saul, and we find evil times today. What are the righteous to do? The answer is persevere. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life which God has promised to those who love him. The crown of life. If you do not have access to the crown of life that God promises, if you've not been persevering, or if you've never made that decision to come into Christ, to become a child of God in the waters of baptism, then this may be an opportunity as we stand and sing a song of invitation.
I cast my mind to Calvary, where Jesus bled and died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet, my Savior.